Hello. Testing, testing.
And then. Yeah, that should be a little fucking covered. Alright, let's flip it.
No, no. Estimate and extra.
Get off with that. And. Which is 1 hour 10.
I'm going to post this on Facebook too.
On deck. Alright, I'm ready whenever you are.
Alright, and just double checking, we did hit the glitch exhibition incentive, right? That'll be after the run, just double checking.
Yeah, we hit that a while ago.
Cool.
Alright.
Do I want to adjust the camera at all, or?
I mean, we can. There we go.
Alright. Well, hello, I'm Kenta. I'm going to be doing a run of Metroid 2 100% no out of bounds for you guys today.
So do the sadist.
No, not. It's a pretty good run. I've been running this game for probably a little under a decade by now. And it's something that I've always been a really big fan of. I feel like it's got a lot of merit compared to a lot of other runs. So without further ado, I think we should get started. Let me make sure save file is nice and clear. And then 3, 2, 1, go. All right, so starting off, there's a couple things you need to know about how movement works in this game. There are three tiers of movement speed. There is walking on the ground, which is the middle tier. There is rolling on the ground, which is the fastest. And then there is being in the air, which is by far the slowest. So, especially at the start of the run, the big focus here is going to be optimizing my rolling as much as possible. I'm going to be trying to, as long as there's enough tiles in a row that it doesn't take longer to morph than it would save, I will be rolling as much as I can. Another big thing, and something that'll be coming up a lot more once I get to the glitch exhibition, is the select glitch. Whenever I hit the select button, there is a small chance that whatever is going to load next in the tile loading algorithm will just glitch out. So we actually have to plan where I hit select in order to make sure that that does not happen during a normal run, because it can kind of ruin your day. We're going to be coming up on our first Alpha Metroid here in just a sec. Alpha Metroids take 5 missiles. They don't really have iframes. They're pretty much the easiest Metroids in general to manipulate. So we're going to be trying to get a shot that lands perfect right above him as he spawns. Should knock him up. And there we go. Alright, so one thing that you're going to see me do right here, or at least attempt to do, it's a little unviable, is, there you go. Damage clip through that enemy. You can cancel the knockback from taking damage by jumping, which also gives you another jump, by the way, because this game's coded pretty well. So you're going to see me abuse that right here to go really quickly up this shaft. Especially near the start of this run, I kind of use the phrase that health is a currency for speed. So, I'll be playing it a little safe, but in general, I'll be doing a lot of damage boosting and stuff like that in order to ascend vertical areas as quickly as possible. And that'll actually be pretty consistent throughout the run, just because most of my normal upwards momentum stuff, like spider ball or space jump, they're all pretty slow. Whereas damage boosting is fast, but it's only really scary in the first part because of how low my overall health cap is. It'll culminate at a trick that's going to be coming up after Area 1, near the start of Area 2, called Skyscraper, where I'll be taking one of the 2 safety saves I take for this run in marathons, because if I fail that trick, then I will not have enough health to try it again. There's a very long series of damage boosts to climb up a tower just before you get Spring Ball, which is an incredibly important movement item in this game. Unlike in every other Metroid game it appears in. And normally I would have rolled under a lot of that acid, but for the sake of keeping my health high, I just chose not to. So, we're out of the mid-tunnel, we're coming to the start of Area 1. This is going to be the Chozo Ruins. The big item that I'm getting here is a bomb. That's going to be the most useful one. And then I'm also getting the Spider Ball, which when combined with the Spring Ball will allow some truly fun damage boosting ridiculousness.
And then real quick, we have a $20 and $5 donation from Matt saying, I don't want your money putting this towards Castlevania and then topping off the other Castlevania. GG.
Thank you, Matt. That means that later on today, I will be doing a run of Castlevania Harmony of Dissonance, maximum any percent. That's awesome.
Put this at $1,100.
Let's go. Alright, so now
$329 to go.
We're past the big scary part now. There's no more enemies. Okay, well, there's one more, but there's no more meaningful enemies between us and the next E-Tank. But this is what I mean about, like, it gets a little spooky for a sec. So, first major item coming right here is bombs. Bombs are important for, obviously, to open paths, but they are also useful for a couple specific areas that I can use them to do boosts before I get the Spring Ball. Allows me to just have a couple quick room strats. So real quick, I'm going to show you, there is different heights when you're jumping. And once you're above a certain height in a normal jump, you cannot control how high Samus goes anymore. So coming up that shaft, we do something called crouch jumping, which limits the height of your jump in order to allow you to... climb up with minimal time wasted in the air. Because like I said, being in the air is incredibly slow, so we want to spend as much time on the ground as possible. Alright, now our health is looking pretty good. This is one of the rooms where we're going to use the bombs for a nice little speed strat. Try and kill this guy. Good, got it. There we go. We open up that bottom path while simultaneously bouncing me up to get those missiles faster. Otherwise, I'm supposed to have to need the spider ball to get those, but spider ball is slow and the climb to get those would take a really long time. So we just don't. So, by the way, you see me unmorphing a lot when I'm falling long distances most of the time. That's because if you touch the ground after falling more than a tile of height, you get a bounce, and that bounce kills a lot of momentum and wastes time. So, therefore, unless it's in an area that I can do a trick called spider throwing, we do our best to avoid as much as possible.
There we go.
You can unmorph jump in this game as well, like in Metroid 1. Okay. So I do that right here out of the spider ball to climb this shaft faster.
Okay, I just wanted to clear. Yeah.
No. We're going to be coming up on our second Alpha Metroid. We're going to be trying to do a quick kill strat to trap him in the corner of the room.
What? Your voice kind of sound out a bit there. Oh, I'm very out of it.
So we're going to do another unmorph jump here. Guide him into the path. Come on. No! That's the risk, is you need to be like right in the door to guide him it correctly. Well, that's fine. He doesn't always act nice, but it's not a big deal. Health's not too scary here. And that is our first spider throw. Whenever you get upwards momentum that's not from a bomb while you're in Morph Ball, so either bouncing on the ground or using the spring ball, you can do something called spider throwing, which is where you activate spider ball, and then for some reason we haven't really figured out, only when moving to the left, you can gain motion in the air equal to it if you were rolling on the ground or running with a Varia suit. That is not something I didn't mention earlier when I was talking about movement stuff, is that a Varia suit actually increases your grounded running speed. And I believe the only Metroid game to do that. Alright, so now we finished up in the ruins, getting our items and everything like that. So now we're going to be heading down to the bottom half of Area 1, which is one of the various Metroid hives. Got a few more alphas to clear out down there, and then we'll be heading off to Area 2 to do a skyscraper.
Yeah.
try and get, okay. It can be a little kitschy whether or not the, it works to get me onto there, but it all worked out. Another little unmorph jump. This is going to be here. We're going to be trying to get through the sand before that that guy swoops around for the second pass. And there we go. Alright, this next room always looks a little cool. They call this the pancake room. We got a lot of these little pancake enemies. We have to shoot the missiles at very specific times in order to kill all the enemies without running into them. One of the room strats that I helped develop back when I was still relatively new to running this game. I did a lot of strat research and optimization of Metroids. And then, I'm gonna be doing the thing on the way back, but actually changed strat a little bit. Oops. Supposed to throw that missile up, but doesn't really waste too much time if I miss. So the big thing with these Metroids in order to save time is it's kind of RNG, unfortunately. It's kind of RNG whether or not they dive to the left or the right after you hit them. You want them to dive to the left so that they can, you can get closer to the door and have to move less after killing them, but it's not really under your control. Alright, this is going to be another Metroid I try to do a quick kill on. Hopefully I don't scoop myself out of the room like I did last time. You have to get pretty close to the door for the door. There we go. Yeah, you can trap Metroids in the ceiling. Obviously it's not quite intentional, but it's very, very useful. Their hitboxes kind of stick down enough that you can hit them even as they're slowly getting pushed up into the ceiling. Quick little damage boost. Nice. There we go. And that is area one complete. Good. One, two, three. I'm going to refill our health real quick here. This is important because we need that health for the tree I mentioned earlier, Skyscraper. As I said, health is still a currency for speed, so we have to spend some of it to get there, but we need to keep our health pretty high. We'll be coming back to that last room, the last vertical shaft I was in a bit later for the glitch exhibition. Got some cool warp stuff to show off there. So the select glitch I mentioned earlier, just to go over that since there's not a lot going on right now, the select glitch I mentioned earlier can also be used to go out of bounds, and that leads to some interesting strats. Not a lot of people run the category, just because like this is kind of an easier one to learn and select glitch can be kind of unreliable, but you can do some cool things like warping between the first three areas and warping between the Omega's layer directly to Queen without the really long run up without any enemies. There's also some cool out of bounds secret worlds you can explore, but I'll get more into that when I get to the glitches. See me using spider throwing whenever I can here, but it's really gonna change once I get the spring ball, which is why we go up the right side of the tower in this upcoming area, the right side of the skyscraper, rather than waiting and going around, because it saves so much time once we get spring ball and can start spider throwing on a consistent basis. It's also when you'll see a pretty big differentiation in room strats at that point, because since spider throwing only works when going to the left, you actually have to like route each room differently depending on the direction you're moving through it. Interesting little quirk of this game. I actually think that Metroid 2 is probably the next most technical Metroid after Super Metroid. This doesn't get talked about a lot because it's kind of the dark horse of the family. This is going to be my one of my two safety saves. Saving this game is very convenient because there's like literally this instant. Quick bomb on warp jump here in order to get up here, and then so for skyscraper, we're coming up the right side of this. We're gonna go up this wall. We wait just a moment because this enemy will run into it if we keep going at the normal pace. So now we go in here, we'll collect the missile, and the trick will start once we come out. We do an unmorph jump, do damage jumps off of these enemies. Didn't quite make it. This is what I mean about, like, it can burn a lot of health if it goes wrong. So now I gotta be careful. I happened to die somewhere up close, that's why I took the safety save. But if I change up myself a little bit, I think I should be fine. Alright, now we got the spring ball. Excuse me, I might not talk much here. I got focused on not getting hit.
Alright, then what we'll do is we'll tell you a little bit about our sponsor that is going to be Two Right Love on her arms. They are a nonprofit dedicated to finding hope and help for those suffering with mental health problems, addiction, self-harm, and suicide. If you want to find out more about them, go to TWLOHA.com.
Okay, should be good. Can get a little bit spooky. Skyscraper went a little rougher than it normally would, but it's a little easy. If you don't hit the rhythm perfectly, it's really hard to get back into it. You gotta, because of the cycles of those enemies that are moving around in the air, kind of get desynced. Alright, so the important thing here, when you drop this bomb, I need to wait for it to explode before I move, because there's an opening pathway down there, and I can just drop down instead of having to go and wait for the bomb to lay, or wait and lay a bomb again. This is why I won't be showing off, but we actually figured out that with the select glitch coming into this room, if you come at it from, I can't remember if it's the right or the left, but if you come at it from one of the directions, you can actually spawn a hole in this wall and avoid having to go back up and around. One of the neat little time saves that you can get by playing around with the blocks and the loading. Fun little jump here called the Three Stooges, because we bounced off three of these little chicken turret face enemies. And we'll be cleaning up a few more items, like missile packs. Then we'll be heading up out of this area and heading to go get Vary suit. As I mentioned earlier, Vary suit is a very important item. It ups your run speed, so it makes worrying about rolling strats pretty much non-existent outside of areas where like you literally need to roll because of a morph ball tunnel, which is a one heck of a time save, let me tell you. And it makes movement after that point much less stressful too, because I haven't done it humanity nearly as much at once. There's been a lot of recent improvement in this game because of people like Behemoth and Scotty W really taking this game to its heights. Oh, missed the jump. There we go. We've kind of went through a couple different round like phases of like improvement in this game. There was me and then Empty Eye, who was the world record holder for probably the longest uncontested time frame. Then Kirby Master and Chronix also started contributing to strats for this game for a while. Then they kind of dropped out of it. And then we had a relatively recent rebirth where Behemoth, Metroid McFly, and a couple of other people started running the game, which ended with Scotty joining it, and now Scotty has the world record in 100% and 100% 100% no out of bounds and 100% without bounds. Alright, we're gonna be trying to get a manipulation on this Metroid. Oh, almost got it. Darn. If it goes absolutely perfectly, I can get him trapped in this corner right here and kill him pretty much instantly. I almost got it, but it was just a little off. Alright, so down here is going to be where we're going to get the Vary suit. We're getting one more alpha before we fight that, as well as a missile pack that a lot of people don't really realize exists when they play this game casually, because it's really far tucked away back. All the way back here, and it is totally unmarked secret behind all of these destroyable walls, is one little missile pack. An interesting thing about the missile tanks in this game compared to the other Metroid games is they actually give you 10 missiles instead of 5, which means there's a lot less missile pickups overall for a relatively comparable final missile count. I believe it's 250, maybe 220. I messed it up right there, but what I've been trying to do to minimize my landings is if I do a spider ball on the wall, just and then immediately tap back out of it, I will not bounce, which just saves those couple of frames of the bouncing animation. I'm gonna try and excavate this out a little bit as I break open the rest of it. And now we get the Mario suit. Health and that health especially now is much, much less of a concern. You can spend it a lot more freely to move quickly without having to really worry too much about dying. The only place that health can get sketchy is, again, is like one area where you have to do a only sequence break that we do in this game, and then right at the end of the game, where the omegas and everything like that can end up making it a little sketchy. But there are refills before both of those, so if my health is anywhere near dangerous, I will just go and make sure to take the refill. I've done this run in plenty of marathons. I'm not gonna risk marathon safety over wanting to go fast. Alright, so we're going up to another interesting boss. We're gonna be seeing our first Gamma Metroid. Gammas are, in my opinion, some of the worst Metroids in the game. So, with Zeta Metroids are the generally argued worst Metroid in the game because they turn into a disaster if their setup fails, but their setups are relatively easy and you just kind of just have to hope the RNG didn't screw you over. But with Gammas, their setups are generally more involved because they have kind of a long invincibility period that they activate after they attack. Alright, but we got this one locked up nice and tight. So, a recent discovery to make this lock a lot easier is that this game has auto-fire with missiles, where if you just hold down the button, it'll fire another one as soon as it is able, and the auto-fire rate is actually the perfect rate to keep them stun-locked without being able to activate their invincibility periods. You just try to get past this alpha, and then hope he cooperates with his RNG, which he was pretty good about. This is, I didn't really talk about it, by the way, because I was so focused on the health thing, but you're seeing me do spider throwing now, where I am able to move through the air a lot faster. It makes going at least leftwards through most rooms a lot less of a hassle. I don't have to plan movement too heavily as long as I'm not running into things. But going right is where I have to be, like, careful. So there's one more Gamma, and we'll be getting, then that'll be all the Metroids for this area, but there is actually one more thing we have to do before we leave. There's one last missile pack that there's just no convenient time to go and get before this point, so we gotta make sure to go and pick it up on the way out of the area. This is Sand Gamma 1.0. Later on in the run, we'll be eating true Sand Gamma, but this is a baby form. This one, the sand doesn't really affect the fight. We just hauled that because the area is obviously incredibly sandy. So, by the way, what I'm doing there, the reason why I would stop fighting sometimes is because of the invincibility periods that I mentioned. I'm trying to not just waste missiles for no reason while fighting him. Yeah, with spring jumps, unmorph jumps, damage boosts, and stuff like that, we can really make vertical movement very, very quick, which is always convenient. Climbing up this shit, I have to go get that last missile.
Did you read off the... Well, that means you got a little bit.
This is a little tight. We just gotta make sure we bounce up correctly and re-anchor ourselves. It's a little easy to fall, waste some time. But it's not dangerous or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
Alright. And then there we go. We are done with Area 2. We're going to be heading down to Area 3.
See you later, buddy. We'll see you later. Yeah.
See you guys around. Yeah, those are not actually bomb blocks. Those are shot blocks. But because of the position of it, I can't just shoot them out to clear them, unfortunately. Really nice if I could. But they respawn as soon as you're off screen, so I can't even, like, go under them and redo it. It's a little unfortunate. This enemy's kind of a prick, so we kind of just try to ignore him. All the mechanical enemies in this game can take one heck of a beating, especially because we don't get any of the stronger beams in this run. We only get Ice Beam. That might sound a little weird in terms of being 100% run and all, but turns out that this game does not actually pay attention to what you pick up. It knows what beam you have, but it doesn't know where you got it, and it doesn't know when you got it. So you can actually like go into a room, collect a beam power-up, and then leave the room and walk back in, and the beam will just respawn, like it were a drop from an enemy or something like that. And so we decided that since there's already an area right at the end of the game where you have to collect, there's an area right at the end of the game inside the last main area before the Omegas called the Tower, where you can get all of the beams just right on top of each other. It is just one long shaft that allows you to collect all the beams that you want. We decided that the only difference between picking them up and not is just going up that one shaft as opposed to just getting the ice beam from the bottom of it, that we aren't really gonna bother with that. It wasn't really a skill check or anything like that, and the game does not track it anyways, so we felt it was kind of a pointless endeavor. Alright, so we're coming into Area 3. Doing the thing I mentioned earlier with, like, spider-balling off the walls to make movement as smooth as I can. This pit where I'm going to be crossing right now is going to be relevant when coming out of the area. It's going to be where we're going to be doing the acid dive, which is our only major sequence break in the game. The game expects us to go back out into the main shaft after clearing out Area 3, and then go down this long hallway, kill this one Metroid, and then come all the way back to that pit, which will now be open. We don't want to do that. That wastes like 5 minutes or more. So instead, we just face tank through it, because it's the only acid pit in the game that is not blocked off or like health gated because we can't get enough health before it. So we take advantage of that and just go right down it. Had a little bit of an incident with it in a Metroid relay race where I cut it really close and came out of it with only 12 health, but we won't be cutting it that close this time. I will just refill if my health seems that low by the 8-point in Area 3 where there's a refill.
Was there a refill down there, or why didn't the missile pack go away?
That was a missile refill.
Okay.
Yeah, the missile... This is the first game with health and missile refills, which are really, really important because we have to burn so many missiles fighting Metroids that and there's so few enemies, like... Missile drops in this game are an incredibly rare pickup. There's only a few enemies in the game that do it. All enemies are locked into whatever they drop. Like, enemies that drop small health will only ever drop small health. Enemies that drop big health will only drop big. Enemies that drop missiles will only drop missiles. And there's only a few enemies in the game that actually drop missiles. So rather than deal with having to just try and farm them off of, like, a couple enemies in the game, they just gave us missile refills, which is, I think, quite a blessing. It'd be unbelievable pain to farm up missiles, even with all the ones we get from the various missile packs. I still have to refill more than once. That is a missile pack. I can just grab it through the wall because collision, lol. Alright, so we're coming up on, the next energy tank. We just avoid this Metroid for now. We'll fight him when we come back up. To the left there is what I would argue is the hardest Metroid in the game in terms of setup. I find it incredibly unreliable. Part of it is, like, I just had trouble figuring out the strat personally, but I even see a lot of the other high-level runners of this game struggling to keep that Metroid in check. He does not like to cooperate. So, there's something there that I hadn't explained yet. When you unmorph, if you're taking damage, you will immediately cancel the iframes and keep moving. So that is something that we do in that area because those are one of the only enemies in this game with RNG outside of the Metroids. And so we just keep ourselves morphed coming through there in order to maximize our ability to just keep moving. That is something I hadn't actually mentioned yet. I think Metroid 2 is a great game for a lot of people to pick up as their first speedrun. It's relatively straightforward. The movement, while technical, isn't overwhelming, and you can still have a pretty reasonably good run without the best movement. And outside of the Metroids and a couple of specific types of enemies, like those fire geyser guys, there is no other enemy RNG in the entire game. So runes are incredibly consistent most of the time. It's a very honest game. You can feel your skill improvements as long as you put in the effort to improve. So now heading over to that troublesome Metroid I mentioned earlier. Spider throwing can be a little tricky. You gotta make sure you avoid getting stuck on like ceilings and stuff like that. Alright, come on. Move back. Get in there. No! Ah, darn it. So the ideal way to do it is to get him stuck right down the corner right there. That actually still wasn't too bad. He didn't get too far. I was able to get some pot shots into him. But in a perfect world, I can just get him stuck in that far left corner after the block respawns, and he literally can't do anything. That Metroid is cooperating very nicely. Another missile pack that a lot of people don't necessarily realize is here, hidden right up here, above the room when you come in. This is actually a route change compared to how we used to do it. Originally, when I first started running this game, we would always do this interior section of the ruins second after doing the outside. But it's actually a little bit faster if you do it this way. And it works out pretty much the same in terms of like health routing and stuff like that, because either way, you're getting either this energy tank or that other energy tank I got. But once you come back up from this area, you can just spider throw to get out of here, which makes it a little bit faster. Sounds like someone's here.
Right? Or leaving. Should they stay or should they go now?
That's another case where we had to bomb that block because there's not really a good place to unmorph. There's actually a small tile gap that I can do, but it's really hard to find reliably. So I kind of just tend to bomb it instead. It's a very minimal time loss. So we just kind of fall down onto this guy on purpose to get him to go come up here. And then kind of just do our best. Like I said, Metroids aren't the kindest. And see, he wasn't being too nice there. He kept bouncing off to the right. But we want him to just stay on the left wall for as long as we can. Alright, and that is the top half of Area 2 done. Or Area 3, rather. I always like these dangers. It's got a fun rhythm to it. You really gotta wonder, like, did they I feel like they had to have caught in development the fact that you can literally get your jump back anytime you get hit by something, but maybe they just left
times.
It in for fun.
There were simpler times, so they didn't think about it. I mean, if you think about it, like, how early these were, Super Nintendo era stuff, like, unless you had a big team, I don't know how big of a team this was. I don't know, they didn't have a lot of time for or resources for quality testing.
Well, this is actually, Metroid 2 is made by Nintendo R&D1.
Oh, there you go.
So they were one of Nintendo's premier teams, headed up by Gunpei Yokoi. That's actually the reason why the game looks like this, too. This isn't a normal Game Boy palette. When they designed the Game Boy Color, they explicitly coded in a special palette just for Metroid 2.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, because the same people that made this game made the Game Boy Color. This is always a fun little strat. It's a very smooth, easy, quick kill. You just gotta get hit like once, and then big delete.
See, that's why they went extinct.
We're gonna be trying to do a quick little damage boost up here off of this Metroid. Almost got it. There we go. We want to kill him on the way out of the room because it's faster, and we don't want to have to spider ball up the wall to get to the Metroids hiding behind him. Cut away into the back room. I can do the Metroid a little bit faster if I climb up there, but I can take a lot of extra damage if I do that. So, like I said, I'm trying to conserve my health, so trying. I didn't quite get it. You can get the trick to go through him, though. Nice RNG from that, actually. Move right over to where I wanted to go. Alright, so how I do on this Metroid is pretty much the make or break for whether or not I decide to refill. If it goes bad and I get below, like, 3 tanks, I'm definitely going to refill. Over here. Get down. Alright, he did pretty nice. As long as I don't let any of the other extras get out of control, I should be have no problem. Very nice. I didn't even take damage on that setup. Oh, but he didn't stay. Darn it. Down here. I've never actually seen that Metroid escape from the quick kill setup like that before. That's never happened before. To quote the eternal meme.
Bingo!
Alright, we're not gonna fight this Metroid immediately. We're gonna kind of just scoot right by him, because the quick kill setup is actually, kind of passing. Alright, well, hold on. Never mind. We'll play it safe. He didn't want to comply, so we'll just take it nice and slow. I want to make sure to have nice health for the acid trip, so I don't want to take any risks. Alright. That is our last damage check for that. So, you're going to see me. I could be spider throwing in here, and if I were trying to do like a PB attempt, I would be. But so the thing with spider throwing and in the acid is that it cancels any iframes that you have. Like so if you try and spider throw an acid, your health just melts. Like, I would probably lose 2 tanks in like the space it took to get across like this room if I were spider throwing. And so it's faster, but it's also very dangerous. Now, the weird thing is, if I hold jump, I see I barely take any damage. So as long as I'm not actively in spider ball while I'm in the acid, it doesn't happen. You can see this room's even still filled with acid, because it's supposed to have drained, but we're not supposed to be here.
Yeah. We have shifts. Figuring it out as we go. Just walking in now. I think he'll be doing that.
Quick's run and a couple
of them. Croak's on. Okay. There it goes. Quick. I am unsure.
Alright, we have one more Metroid to kill in this area, but you see the ground shaking because that was the one that was supposed to move. That's the acid dropping in here. Because I was supposed to have gone and killed other Metroids. That's an interesting thing about the game, is it doesn't check which Metroid you killed as long as you've killed Metroids.
Which can't wait.
Makes the number go down regardless. Which is a blessing, because it allows us to do the sequence break. If it checked which Metroids you've killed, then it wouldn't work, even if we could get through that. So we're going to run over and grab a quick missile refill as well. The area, ironically, works out nicely for us in giving us health and missile refills after to go down to these Metroids. Because if it didn't, it would make this entire section super scary in a PB attempt. Since you have to be dealing with low health and low missiles while trying to fight these Metroids. Because in what we call the Squid Cave, there's a little potential to get some health back, but it's still not fast. That's a new one. I've never seen one of those guys spawn in the doorframe before.
It's never happened before.
Again. Every once in a while, something weird like that happens. When I was recording my old tutorial for this game, One of those extending plant enemies that you saw at the top of Area 2 after I did the skyscraper, one of them just randomly appeared in the middle of the void as I was spider-throwing across to get to the Metroid in the big side of the void. Like, I've never seen it happen before or since, and this giant plant just teleported itself right into the middle of my jump, and I died, and I was like, what the fuck just happened? Alright.
And then real quick, an update on some of the donation incentives. We are at $10 of 50 for forcing PGA to do Mindskip and DuckTales Remaster, which is a darn near impossible trick. 40 of 150 for Kenta to do Castlevania Aria of Sorrow Soma 80% old route. We were at $0 of $100 for me to do a Hurricane Dab on stream because, like me, probably no one knows what that is. 765 of 150 for Matt for Silver Hair. And then for the polls we have open, we have Wave Race 64, music or no music. And that right now is music on, is leading 35.31 to $31. And Wave Race 64, Day is Color, green is leading $15 to 5 for brown.
Alright. So this entire area is where we were supposed to go before we did the acid trip, but as you can see, it's rather involved, so we didn't really want to bother. So there's one gamma to kill over here, and then once we do that, we'll be heading down towards Area 4, the tower. That is going to be where you see probably the highest variance in my performance on Metroids, because Zen Metroids suck, and if they decide that they want to hit me with their fireballs while I'm doing the quick kill on them, then I'll just have to reset them, unless I'm really far in the fight, in which case I'll probably just have to tough it out. Not fun. Speaking of not fun, this guy's not like well. Just as a quick side, we do have a Metroid 2 Discord if this run looks fun to you guys. It's a little out of date, but we do still have a pretty thorough tutorial that I made many, many years ago. If you go to the Metroid 2 leaderboard on speedrun.com, we have rune strats, we have a link to our Discord, and you can see a lot of the PBs up there, including my own. A lot of well-known people in the Metroid community have come to this game as of relatively recently, or came back to it, for Behemoth, for example, from the Super Metroid community.
Well, once you conquer any percent, I mean, what more is there?
Metroid 2 is the final frontier.
Exactly.
I have to purposely, instead of doing like the high spider throws that you normally see doing, I have to purposely do them low here, because if I do them high, I'll run into the bats, and if I don't do them quickly, those guys will come up out of the ground and hit me. I'm gonna take another safety save in this tower, just because I'm gonna be a little variable as to how this goes, and I literally have to go right past the save anyways, so there's no point in not saving. Now there's a Metroid here, but we're just gonna go right on by him. We're gonna fight them on the way out of the area. We don't wanna bother right now. So just bye. Yeah, this is also the tower is where we'll be finishing up all of our item collection. The last set of items that we need is here. So for the Omegas and like the area leading up to the queen, there is actually not any items at all. It's just purely execution. Don't need to worry about collecting. Yep, here's our safety save. I'm comfortable having like two tanks here, so just under isn't a huge deal, but just rather play it safe. Don't lose the run this far in. These spike rooms are kind of a pain, but we take pretty minimal damage on per individual spike up. I might have to reset this since I fell down, but we'll see how it goes. Yep, there we go. So, welcome to Xenometroids. They suck. If they don't want to play nice, then you get this, where I have to, like, just kind of pump missiles into them and hope. So, what the Stunlock is right when they spawn on their initial swoop, they'll keep trying to swoop at you as long as you keep hitting them with missiles. And so you can get them locked into that and then just kill them before they have a chance to do anything. However, every time that you hit them, they also have a mild RNG chance to shoot a fireball. If they shoot a fireball, then your attempt at the quick kill is fucked. It is very annoying. So this is what I mentioned earlier. If I kept climbing up the tower, I could collect all three of the other beams, but we decided that that's just not really necessary because it's just literally just climbing up this room. That's all. Not really. It doesn't really require any extra effort. Alright. Now we are going to the worst Metroid in the game. Because it's only a game off, but there's no setup. You have literally figured out nothing. The best I've ever been able to do is kind of get him stuck above the door. But other than that, it's literally just like fighting him raw, and there's not any good way to do it, and it's very slow and annoying. So, since being in the air is so slow, we will actually purposely damage boost off of these spikes so that we get a few iframes to run on the spikes down there, because every time that we successfully do that, we gain just a little bit more time. Alright. So, kind of extended climb up here, then we'll be going into the dark room. There's one room in the game where there is absolutely no light. It's not even like in like Link to the Past, where like you only have to deal with dark room stuff if you don't have a lamp. Like, nope, you just have to deal with it. And so we have to memorize the layout of this room, and hopefully everything goes fine. It can get a little dicey if you're not careful. The first part is easy enough. You just need to fire straight down and come in to get this missile, but it's a little hard to tell sometimes if you make it into the path to the other section of it, which lets you go up and get the energy tank. Okay, get back here now. Alright, should be in the right spot. Yes, okay, good. You cannot see anything at all. Now, fun fact, there is actually 6 E-tanks, even though you can only hold 5. And since there are individual collectibles that do not respawn, we still have to collect it. But it's not far. It's actually right up here, hiding up in the ceiling. A lot of people don't even ever realize that this exists. Like, even more than that one miscellaneous two that was hidden in the ceiling, because, like, there's, like, no reason at all to come up here. By the way, that's what I was talking about being careful about not falling off when you do this. You kind of want to move to the right so you get bounced up. But there's, like, no reason at all to think to check the ceiling in this area. Whereas, like, you have to be up in the ceiling anyways to get to that other Metroid in the vanilla Area 2 stuff. But, the missile tank and a, E-tank. Now, we are heading over to True Sand Gamma. He is literally an entire room full of sand. It's not like the other one where there's, like, sandy paths. Like, the entire room is just sand. So you actually have to shoot out the path and even just to get around him. There is a setup for him. It's not the most reliable, so we'll see if we can get it. Really gotta have good mashing to deal with the sand runes. You gotta kind of lead him behind you. Maybe? Ah, no. Okay. Darn it. Alright, well, that wasn't too bad. So, next thing we're going to be doing here is a little trick called the Zeta Zag. It's just a bit of a precise spider throw. We're going to spider throw into a Zeta Metroid as it sheds its shell to bounce us up into the little hole you see in the ceiling right there so we can get the screw attack before we fight it. The screw attack makes fighting Zeta Metroids much easier because it allows you to reset them if they give you a bad pattern and just get them off of you. However, unfortunately, just the way the route works out, we don't get until the second to last Zeta. And honestly, neither Zeta that you actually use it on really works, so it's mainly useful for the Omega Metroids if you get a bad pattern. What's nice about the Omegas, though, is that they're entirely deterministic. They'll go the same places and do the same things as long as you always do the same things, unlike, say, the Alphas. So that's a nice little bonus. Uh-oh. You're not being nice. Right. Alright, I'm gonna drift out the room. Every once in a while, they'll give you a bad lunge like that. And again, just that is how the worst Metroids. So now we gotta, this one is a bit more involved. We gotta keep moving forward as it goes up. There we go. Okay. All right. And there's one more Zeta and one more Gamma in this area. Okay, refill our missiles. This is the last time we filled them up unless I end up needing it. By the way, 240, so we are good on missiles. We didn't miss any. Bad. God, you can get him just like stuck right up here on the wall. And that's that. All night. So right here. 100%. That's all the items. Now it's just Metroid left to kill, and we get off this crazy planet.
And I'd like to shout out Dopefish for a $20 donation saying, keep up the good work. And that went towards something. Let's look. It did not go towards a pole, but it does look like, let's see, it went towards the area of Sorrow Summit 8% old route. We are now at 60 of 150.
Thank you, Dopefish. Good friend of mine. I've known him for a long time. He is also known for getting surprisingly large donations to GDQ every year. Every once in a while, he'll pop up with some ridiculous donation.
Wow. But, hey.
He gives a lot to charity. Sure. He's a great guy.
That's a great guy. Thank you, Dopefish. You are a gentleman or woman and a scholar.
All right.
Or Apache attack helicopter.
All right, so this got to kill. This is technically the lactate Metroid of the area. He doesn't. There's a way to get him really fast towards the end of the room, but I tend to do it a little safer just because it's kind of unreliable and you end up running into the Metroid a lot. So we are now done with Zeta Metroids. We are heading down to the Omegas. There's going to be one thing where we face our last Alpha Metroid, and then we go and fight an Omega in the same room.
You have a nice spin.
Yep.
Shows you how alive I am right now.
Yeah, I picked that up in Area 4. Remember I was talking about why we don't pick up the beams for 100%?
Yeah, something about a tunnel at the end.
Yeah, there's the shaft right there that I picked up the ice beam in. The other three beams are just in item rooms that are like directly above it in that one contiguous area. So it's like after they introduce each beam to you separately, they just give you a choice so you can choose whatever beam you want towards the end of the game. But because of that and the fact that they're not like consistent pickups or anything like that, we decided that it's not really worth collecting them all when we have to, when the big game doesn't count them anyways. It doesn't even know which one we pick up. As compared to the extra E-Tank, which even though it doesn't show in our HUD, is a discrete, like, collectible that you have, that you get and then does not come back.
For the truly dedicated fans.
There is more of them.
I can't see ever encountering that in a casual run.
Yeah, no, like, you have to know it's there. A lot of people didn't even realize it existed for a really long time. Yeah, so we're supposed to like go down in a loop and come back into that room from the other side, but that's way too slow, so we just go right back up the same path we just came. Because all we need to do is enter that room to trigger the change in state of these rooms.
Thank you.
one.
So Omegas are interesting. They have a weak point on their back where they take triple damage from missiles. So the biggest thing is to manipulate them into exposing that weak point and then hit. If you do them perfectly, they will never actually get a chance to move. You can just stun lock them. So once you hit them in the back, there is like a timer that starts counting down. There's a timer that starts counting down, then it stuns them in place for that time frame. And while you're hitting them with more missiles, that timer does not count down. So while they're in the iframes, while missiles will pass through them, then that timer is not counting down. So the idea is to just keep shooting them, like try and place your shot so that like they are inside of the omegas before that frame happens. So they'll hit the omega on the first possible frame and keep them in the stun lock for as long as possible. And if you do it correctly, then they'll never even have a chance to move. So they are generally a lot easier than the Zetas, despite technically having more health because of their weak point system. TLDR, hit the weak point for massive damage.
What's your PB in this?
It's a 102.24.
Is there any chance that we're going to achieve that?
I don't think so. I would say that I'd be pretty surprised, but I wouldn't say it's out of the question. I would say based on how things have gone, it's not super likely. It's not a bad run by any means. This is probably like 103, 104 pace, I would say.
Not bad.
Nothing went like particularly crazy wrong or anything. Did I miss the... Nope. So in the Omega area, you get a little bit of like Metroid 1 level design. Like this same room appears like 3 times. But it works out because it's a nice consistent room for spider balls, spider throwing traps. It's only going to the right that's really slow because you have to jump a lot. Alright, so this is the first... I've been doing that a bunch recently. I've been pulling back just a little too early. So the ideal strat here is we want to run to the right as quickly as possible, and then when he lunges, jump, and it sets us inside of him, where we can start using that weak point. If you look, my missiles were actually inside of his body before they like hit him, and that's because like their missiles don't even go into them during their iframe. Their missiles don't get even bonk off them during iframes, they just go inside of them, which is actually a positive because it allows us to do that strat. We are below 2 tanks right now, so if I maintain this health, I'm probably going to do a refill just for safety's sake near the queen. But we'll see, because there's a couple of enemies that I can screw back into and get some large health drops from, and if that goes well, then I might not need to.
And then hello, Tiger Potato, and I do want to remind everybody about our charity, To Write Love on Our Arms. They are a non-profit movement dedicated to presenting hope and finding help for people struggling with depression, addiction, self-injury, and suicide. They exist to encourage, inform, inspire, and also to invest directly in treatment and recovery. You can find out more at TWLOHA.com. And every single dollar that you guys donate goes directly to the charity. It never touches our hands. Through Tiltify integration, which appears to only be working with cards for some reason and not PayPal. Something with Tiltify is something we can't control. But it's a great cause near and dear to my heart, and really, really happy with how much we've raised for them so far. So thanks everybody for your generosity.
So pretty good so far. And yeah, I'm probably going to take that refill just for safety's sake. That'll remove any sort of potential problems I could run into when getting grabbed by Metroid. Metroids in this game are like the ones in Metroid 1 where they don't really like cooperate. They won't get off you. So like you can sometimes end up bombing them 3 or 4 times before they get off you, and then you lose a lot of health. Yeah, the optimal strategy is just trying to spend as much time as possible walking on the pillars, because it's so slow to be in the air. Before we figured out the easy setups for the other perfect Metroid, this was the one we had always figured out because it sets itself up very smoothly to jump right into your line of fire. so that's the last of the Omegas. Now we just have the Queen Metroid and the larval Metroid that she spawns left. You have, there's not a lot to say, just a lot of movement right here, so if there's anything else you want to go over, donation incentives, anything like that.
So for donation incentives, for polls, we have Wave Race 64 music or no music. Music on is $35.31 to $31 for music off. I personally want to see the music on for that run, even though it's a little bit slower. So if you're looking to donate to something, that's one that's near dear to my heart. Library 64, Days Color, Green is ahead, $35 to $5 for Brown. And then for the challenges, we have 10 of 50 for DuckTales Remastered Mindskip, 60 of 150 for Temple of Castlevania, Aria of Sorrow, Soma 80% Old Route, and then 765 out of 150 for Matt getting his hair dyed silver. And kind of tell us a little bit about the Aria of Sorrow, Soma 80%.
Alright, so, there's two different Castlevania runs that I do, which is the maximum 80% that we hit the goal for, and then this other one. Soma 80% is, it's a really interesting run because, it's not a lot of heavy technical movement, but instead it shows off a lot of, like, the little, like, weirdnesses in Aria of Sorrow. For example, there's a, fun shop glitch where you get rid of all the items in your inventory, then hit L and R, and then for some reason you can go up and sell the shopkeeper's face, which both gives you a ton of money and actually overflows the potion value. You're only supposed to be able to hold 9 and you end up with 120. And then there's a lot of cool zipping that takes place in there too, through different means, using like the bat or backdashing off of the Gorgon enemies. And it's a great showcase of just classic Konami platforming engine shenanigans, because all of the Metroidvania games have their own, like, brokenness and stuff like that, and I find that makes them just really fun to run, because they all have their own little quirks that allow you to, like, take the game in your own way. There's been, there's a lot of talk in the speedrunning community about, like, zips and whether or not, like, they're, like, worthwhile runs and stuff like that, but I'm of the opinion that, these kinds of things add value to a run, because it allows you to experience a game that you already love in a new way. And so it'd be cool to be able to show that off for a game that I hold very near and dear to my heart. I've been playing Castlevania Aria of Sorrow for a really long time, since I was much younger, and it's always really nice to be able to show people just another way to appreciate the game. A lot of times when I'm doing these kinds of runs, I will, like, I'll learn glitches even if I don't play in the speedrun of the game, just because it's something new to appreciate about it and find a new element to it.
Okay, and real quick, I want to say, Mr. J. Giggles, thank you so much for that $100 donation.
Holy cow.
Sorry I couldn't make it to the event. Keep up the great work for a great charity, killing all the things in record time. Thank you so much. And that went to something. Let's see what it went to. Music On. $100 towards Music On for Wave Race 64. Thank you so much, Mr. Jake Giggles, for your $100 donation.
Did you put anything towards the incentives?
He did not. They're just challenges, so. We're good there. Thank you so much, bringing our grand total to $1,220.00.
Uh oh, got it. See, this is why I made sure to get that. So, Metroids are not kind. So, by the way, you guys saw the item stuff go up, but the reason why that happens is because the Queen Metroid spawns these new larval Metroids.
Oh, wait, he did. Let me look. Oh, yeah, Hurricane Dev. He donated to $100 to. Alright.
You're gonna have to look up a video on that.
I know how to do it. It's like then you get down and you spin, right? I think.
Alright, so we've killed all the larval Metroids. Now we are coming up to the final boss fight with the Queen Metroid.
So, everybody stick around after this run as well. During the intermission, you'll get that sick-ass Hurricane Dab.
Just as a reminder, the marathon is ending today, so we want to hit those incentives as much as possible. Don't wait. Get your donations in.
Yeah. You gotta hit that, 1,420.69.
Alright. Now, so, the important strats with the Queen Metroid are to shoot her mouth whenever it's open, and then screw attack her projectiles to make her move forward a lot as quickly as possible. So, whenever her mouth is open, and you shoot a missile into it, it'll lock her in place, and I can use bombs in there. She's not really playing nice how I'd like her to, but if she gives me a starting open, yeah, this might work. If she gives me a starting open and she opens her mouth again, I'm one of the only. There we go. I'm one of the only people that does that. In fact, I think I'm the only person I've seen to do that. Where you can get a double round on her. Most people think that like if you get into her mouth once, even if it's on the first one, you can't do it again. But if you unmorph and shoot a missile with the proper timing, you can actually end up getting it into her mouth regardless. All right, but that is it. We no longer have to worry about dying. So it's just a straight shot to the end of the game with a baby Metroid. As I said earlier, if you guys are interested in speedrunning this game, please make sure to go to the Metroid 2 leaderboard on speedruns.com. You can get links to the Discord there, find some neat guides and stuff like that. There's people like, I'm always happy to answer questions. I'm in that Discord frequently. People like Flipside, Behemoth hangs out in there a good bit. I would really love to see more people run this game. It is a amazing game. It is a very technical and fun run, and I would love to see more people speedrunning it. Time is going to be when I enter the ship.
Alright.
I'm going to touch a missile refill, and that will be fine. So I'm going to come down. I'm running across the top of this. I'm going to come down this wall. I'm going to hold right at a certain point, and then once I enter the ship and hit that missile refill, it will be time. A little late. Time.
All right, 1:04:38.
All right, not a bad run.
Thank you so much. All right, so we're gonna be here. Let's flip over.
Not yet.
Oh, he's not over.
Remember, we got the glitch exhibition.
Oh yes.
We hit incentive earlier in the run for a glitch exhibition.
Yes, but we're still gonna flip over this thing real quick because of the donation incentive.
All right, no problem.
And this is a better cam for that. Let's make sure we look up. Make sure we get this right. Okay. Hurricane Dab.
Oh god, who did that?
JGX donated $100.
Jesus
Christ. Wait, nobody has a Hurricane Dab, so I think I know what it is, so we're gonna go with it. Let's go.
Oh god,
yeah. Charity, yeah, hopefully not break something.
Yeah, move that.
Let's move this lamp over.
Don't fall on me. I'm scared.
Don't fall, so as far as I know, you go like this, and then you gotta go like this, and you gotta go. There you go, JGigs, all for you!
God damn it, yes. Give the people what they want.
You got to. Alright, back to the...
Alright, so we ended under Spam, we're a little ahead, so I'm gonna show off a couple of quick glitches for you guys. So, first things I'm gonna be showing you are a couple of the warps that we do in the Out of Bounds categories. We use these to warp between the different areas. They're saying they want to see an encore.
Alright, I'm going to put $25.
Instead for a second one.
For a second.
Alright, so, the, oh, I think my game came got a little off-center. Somehow. Hmm? Maybe it's not.
Hmm?
I saw that.
It's cut off now.
Oh yeah, this is a little border.
Okay.
Yeah, we're fine there.
All right, so just going over it real quick. So as I mentioned earlier, the select glitch, every time you hit the select button while moving, you have a chance for it to just blurt out whatever's in there. And so this allows you to do a couple of different out of bounds manipulations. In the speed runs, it's most useful for either opening up like one block walls to allow you to not need to it's useful to open up one block wall so that you can just pass through them and not have to go back around, and then also to warp between the first, you warp from area 1 to area 2, area 2 to area 3, and then from the Omega Nest to the Queen Metroid area. I'm going to be showing off those warps, and then I'm also going to show you one secret world, which is something that'll happen when you go into an area when the wrong tile set is loaded. It'll try and load it, but the tile sets like aren't contiguous with each other at all, so it turns it this crazy mess. And you can even actually save in some of them. Sometimes the save rooms will just get duplicated everywhere. But work nice and quickly. Fall through the abyss for a minute. And now we are in area 2. One of the reasons why people don't necessarily like doing out of bounds stuff as much is because it skips one of the more interesting tricks of the run, which is skyscraper, because this puts us all the way up to where we would fight Arachnus. Alright, the next one is here. This is the warp to area 2. It's a little less reliable, but also that can happen. now. That's where now we're right here. We would go off to down to the right, bottom of the wall here, and we could just go straight down. Actually, we'd generally want to go left because our missiles are very low. But see, that's kind of what happens when you warp with enemies. Just kind of turn into that abomination. You know, set one. There's. Then this is the one of the to get from the Omega Nest to the Queen's area. This one's probably the most visually interesting out of like the main warps. So that is all background tiles and empty air in like the actual room, and then it just turns into death.
Nice. Gotta break the game to make the game. That made sense.
Yeah, so you have to like space jump up around this. Like this is where this is supposed to be the air for the door. Instead, you just go up around the door transition, and then you actually can fix this. Like you don't just do the rest of the run with it looking like this. You go over to where the Queen Metroid area is. You see, you can hear the music starts playing here, and then you go in under here. Then it fixes the tiles because it forces a reload.
Oh, nice.
And yeah, so those are the main warps for the Out of Bounds category. There's a couple smaller ones as well. And then the other one I want to show you guys is a secret world. So the quick story, I was the one that re-found these things. I didn't find them personally. Jesse D is someone who was one of the managers of a pretty well-known Metroid fan site, the Metroid Database, and he also at one point had his own site discussing the secret worlds. And this was back in like 2004. Like if you look at the homepage, like just look up Jesse D secret worlds on Google, and you can find the homepage for it. And like it is complete like web 3.0, like black backgrounds with like bare like screenshots off in the corner of the
Does
site.
Does he have a link to his MySpace page?
It might, I don't know, I haven't gone through all of them. But he originally established the site for just exploring the game's secret worlds, because they're consistent. You can consistently get into the same secret worlds. And so because of that, I was exploring that, and I found that he talked about the warps that can go between the different areas. Anyways, I'm going to try and open up a path here.
And then would you like to follow this one up with the short donation center that got met?
That'd work.
Since we got the spare time.
Maybe? Nope. I need to squint camera again. Normally it doesn't take too many tries, just doesn't want to. Like I said, this life glitch is pretty unreliable, which is why not a lot of people run the out of bounds category. It was actually working. I'm surprised how quickly it worked for the rest of it. Maybe? Yes, okay. So, now we gotta run all the way to the left. Run back to the right, out of screen. Fall for a few more screens and do another one of these checkered areas, and then over to the right here in this abyss. You can see every one of those save points actually is considered a valid save point by the game, except the text turns into that.
That's solid text right there.
And watch, so like
I think that's it definitely is telling me I can read that it says it's saving in Metroidese.
You know, the game might be just a little bit possessed by Cthulhu, but it's okay. So, the last thing I want to show you guys for the glitch exhibition is, I'm actually going to go and get the baby Metroid. You can get your way. This is actually right near the end of the game, so if I'm real careful, I can make my way slowly down. Space jumping this game is a little unreliable, so it might take a couple of tries, but...
Is there any games where it's not unreliable?
It's pretty useful. It's pretty reliable in like a zero mission. So, by the way, the reason why I'm being so careful is because if I fall, all of these, like the more oblong looking ones, they'll just suck me down to the bottom of them. And then I will be stuck in the wall and I'll have to go reload that save I just did at the top of the area. But you know, the game just isn't a huge fan when you're just like, I'm just gonna break you over my knee now. Thankfully, there is some solid ones. So, that's the baby Metroid egg.
That's a solid egg right there.
That, you know, that thing with, like, eyeballs and shit.
I don't think you should eat that.
So, but if we go right over here, we are now in the back of the queen room, despite the queen still being alive, as you can see by our Metroid counter. And if we go back in here, there's our little buddy.
There you go.
Now, we have glitched ourselves into the end of the game room states. We can't beat the game because the way that the game works is that any missile counter that you touch, once the Metroid counter hits zero, that's what ends the game. So I can't beat the game like killing the queen, and I can't unfortunately take the baby Metroid back to the rest of the game from here. There is, I think some people started to figure out some out-of-bound warps in order to be able to do that, but as it is right now, the path to the rest of the game is closed off because the game thinks that I've beaten the queen, but we now have the baby Metroid and can play on with him in here. So yeah, so that is Metroid 2.
Alright, thanks so much.
Take, give me a quick sec, I can go and get the other emulator set up, but I hope you guys enjoyed that.
Thank you guys so much. And be back shortly.
Just as a quick reminder, we do still have my Aria of Sorrow one that'll be coming up as well, as long as you guys donate. So
yep.
Let's get there.